everybody. I'm Blessed and Free. Welcome back to another episode of DOC TV. I got a fire interview for you guys today. But before we get started, man, if you haven't, go ahead and hit that subscribe button and give this video a thumbs up. So on this show, I talk about prison. I talk about what life's like before prison, during prison, and even after prison. And you hear a lot of stories from me and other people that I bring on this show about what it's like to do time in prison. But what I haven't had is somebody on this show that actually worked at a prison. And he'd only not worked at a prison. He worked at the biggest federal complex in the United States, which is known as COLEMAN. So we're going to get into what he went through being a correctional officer and, you know, what he saw in there and everything in between. So, man, why don't you go ahead and introduce yourself to the people watching at home? What's your name, man, and where are you from?
My name's Rob Farlow, and I'm from South Philadelphia originally. And before I say that, I want to say that I've been watching your program, Josh, and I really like it. I love your interview style, and I really appreciate you having me come on.
Yeah, bro, anytime, man. I always want to hear a perspective, especially from you, man, because the only interaction I've ever had with a correctional officer is usually, you know, not on good terms. So for you to be able to come on and tell us what you saw is, man, I'm grateful to have you on, bro.
Well, just like you want to change hearts and minds about people that do time and ex-offenders and they come back in the community and they do good like yourself, I'm your biggest cheerleader. You want to change the hearts and minds. Well, I want to change the perceptions of the corrections officers too. We're not all mean, abusive people.
Right. No, yeah, I saw that when I was in. You got a few that are, you know, treating people with respect and stuff like that. So, man, what made you want to become a correctional officer?
Well, I came to corrections a different kind of way. First off, my father was convicted of murder when I was a young man and went to prison in Trenton State Prison. My father was in the underworld out of New Jersey, Philadelphia, and he was a pretty bad dude. He used to do a lot of, what they would call back in the old days, he was a bag man. He would deliver money from politicians to bribe cops and judges and shit like that. He ended up killing a guy and going to penitentiary. He got a life sentence without parole. This was in the 1970s, late 1970s. So I used to go see my dad. They used, you know, once a month they would take me up and I would go see him. I also had a stepfather. He was in federal prison. I had cousins that went to prison for drug trafficking. So I grew up in a very bad, in a family that, you know, it wasn't exactly the Cleavers. So my whole thing in life was I wanted to break out of that mold. And I because of that, I played my cards straight. I kept my life straight. I went into the military and I retired at 38. So when I joined the BOP, I was a bit older than the average recruit. I had just had a career in the military of 20 years as a military policeman, canine handler. I'd been to war two times. I was on the ground in Iraq. I was in combat. I was a military policeman. I trained soldiers and sailors how to shoot, how to handcuff search, all police academy stuff. So I had a pretty extensive background before I stepped foot into the prison system. But they were hiring at the time. I was retiring, and it seemed like a good fit for me. And I took the job.
I see that. All right. So, well, first off, before I keep going, I just want to thank you for your service. You know, without people doing what you do, I wouldn't be able to sit in my house and you know, give interviews and do a YouTube channel. So salute to you, bro, for, you know, going to war twice, not only once, but twice, man. That's big shit right there. Mm-hmm. So how did you end up at COLEMAN, man, out of, you know, all the places you could have worked? How do you like go about getting the job at COLEMAN?
Okay, well, it was easy. I went online to the website, USA.gov, USA.gov or whatever it was when I was retiring. I applied. I put an application in online. I figured I wanted to relocate back to Florida. At the time, I was in Italy. I was retiring from Italy. So my mom had moved to Florida with my brother. So I was looking to come to Florida and lay down roots. And they happened to have the largest correctional complex in America, FCC COLEMAN. And they're always hiring, especially a guy like me, a veteran. So it was pretty easy for me because I already had the background check and I had all that stuff done going in. So I was vouched out. So I was a pretty easy hire.
See, when I was in prison, I always used to hear shit like, oh, anybody can be a correctional officer and it's so easy. And, you know, a lot of the times in the prisons I was in, they have, you know, 21-year-olds running a dorm. If not,
big problem.
Yeah. Okay. So we're on the same page with that.
Oh yeah. And well, you got to remember, I worked for the feds, and the difference between a federal CO and a state CO is about $25,000 more a year, with the potential to make six figures with overtime. You don't get that in the state. Okay. So what happens is, a lot of guys, you can get to the feds either one of three ways. You can have a 4-year degree, you could be a veteran, or you can have 3 or more years of solid full-time correctional experience. So a lot of guys, and that's just to qualify. Now, you still got to pass all the tests and the interview, but to just get your foot into the door. So a lot of guys that come from the state institutions have been working at the state institution for 7, 8, 9 years. And their dream was to get into the feds, because when you get into the feds, it's like getting into the major leagues, you know, it's the big money, it's, you know, more prestige. So the state COs that would come in usually had 8 to 10 years. They were sergeants, they were lieutenants, and they would come in. And, you know, a lot of the guys like me that were homegrown inside the feds, we used to shake our heads at the way these guys would come in, because we're like, look, we don't do business that way here.
When you started working there, man, like, was it a culture shock to you to be in that atmosphere and see the things that you saw?
No, it really wasn't, because I'd come, you know, I was in the war. I was in law enforcement for a long time, and in the military. So it really wasn't that big of a shock. It was just a different uniform on another battlefield. That's all it was. I just stepped onto a new battlefield with another uniform. But I was more shocked, me, at the waste of money, at all the nonviolent people that are sitting in prison, just rotting for the stupidest crime, smuggling alligator hides and just bullshit.
Really?
Yeah, bro. It's not all, I mean, people have a perception, all rapists and murders. No, it's not. A majority of the people are in there for nonviolent crimes. The federal government, when they get you, buddy, they hit you hard, especially if it's drugs. And a majority of my guys were sitting there rotting for literally half kilo of crack cocaine, and they get 30 years in prison for it. It's ridiculous. So I was more offended as a taxpayer at the waste of our money, because I'm like, look at all these guys could be doing something. They're in their 20s. You know, they fucked up with crack. And I'd read the PSIs. There was no gun. No one got hit. No one got beat up. No one got killed. And the guys get hit with this big time. And you're like, whoa, this is crazy. Something's wrong here.
I actually have a friend, Chad Marks, and he tries to get people out of federal prison. And he actually got sentenced to, I think it was originally like 40 years for a conspiracy to traffic crack.
Oh, yeah.
So I've heard a lot about that. Like, are there other officers when you're working in there that feel the same way about that? Like, you know, money's getting thrown out the window type shit?
We're rare. People think like me, we're rare. When I came in there, the first day when I got hired, I stood up in the room and they said, say your name and introduce yourself to the, you know, I was a new hire. And what I did was, I was always taught this. I stood up in the room and I said, hi, my name is Rob Farlow. If you do something wrong in front of me, I will report you. That was my first day. I told everybody that. I drew the line in the fucking sand, Josh. And from that point forward, anybody that walked with me, I knew was a straight up dude. Because you're not, because if you as an officer, they have cliques, okay? And they already knew off the bat. I already let them know off the bat. Just like in the old days with the pirate flag. Here's my fucking flag. I'm telling you right now, if you're going to do any fucking fucked up shit around me, I will report you. And from that point forward, it was easy for me.
So what would you say is the average federal prison guard? Like, what is he like, or her? Like, what you saw when you were working there?
Well, it depends on, you know, I think it depends a lot on where the prison's located. Okay. And with us, we have a lot of veterans, of course. We have educated people, and we have people that come from the state system through experience, corrections experience. But I would say, by and large, where I was at, they were big country boys, pickup trucks, you know, and you know, I don't want to say rednecks, but yeah, along that. Where I'm from in South Philly, you guys are rednecks, okay? Yeah. Where I come from, but I don't want to use that term and offend nobody. But hey, what the fuck? But yeah, rednecks.
What did you mean by when you said, if anybody does some fucked up shit around me, I'm going to report it? Like, what did you consider as fucked up shit?
Anything illegal, violating someone's rights, abusing somebody, corruption, whatever it is. You know, if I see something like that, or you're done with me. So I knew from that point forward, there were officers that did not want to work with me. But so they already outed themselves. I knew who they were because I didn't want them around me either. You understand? So that's how that's what I did. I saw officers that were magnificent, great, caring, good, care, custody, control, boom, great officers. And I've seen a lot of shit bags that could not give a fuck. You know what I mean? And would engage in all kinds of just petty shit with people, just to fuck with people. And that just wasn't my style. I didn't do that. I was older. I was 38. You know, my father was in prison. My cousins were in prison. I wouldn't want them treated like that. Therefore, I wouldn't treat nobody else like that. So I had a different headspace when I went into prison.
Yeah. And I talk about this on my channel. In state, the officers like to play a lot of fuck shit kind of mind games with you. You know what I'm saying? So what did you see those officers that you're talking about when you were working in the federal system? Like, if they were a shit bag, like you said, like, how did they move? Like, what were the games that they would do with inmates that you didn't like?
Well, I mean, like, a lot of times they would, you know, when a guy comes up, he's like, hey, I need toilet paper. And the guy goes, oh, well, you got to get the officer would say, well, you got to get that from the unit team. And they only pass that out on Tuesdays. Meanwhile, there's a whole box of fucking toilet paper in there. Yeah. So grab a fucking roll.
I always knew there was a box back
there.
Yeah,
I mean, it's like a crazy thing. You know, it's like, all right, look, here's a roll. Okay, another guy sees it. Okay, here's a roll. Like, look, you know, hey, it is what it is. You got to wait on Tuesday. Got a couple spares in there, but just shit like that. When you know a guy's not bullshitting, you know a guy just got there off the bus, he don't have any of his commissary, he don't have anything, and you still want to play fucking games with the guy. You know, oh, I gotta, you know, you gotta sleep without a mattress tonight because I gotta wait till they open up the office tomorrow. It's all it's bullshit. You can go in there. This laziness.
Yeah. And what did you see as far as, like, when you said, you know, the officers would beat inmates and do shit like that? Like, did you see that firsthand?
Well, they knew better. They really did. They knew better to do it in front of me because they never did it in front of me. I had a supervisor that I reported one time because I had an inmate. You remember, I don't know if they do this in the state. It's called dry cell, where they used
to. Oh, yeah.
Guy, they said he ingested balloons in the visiting room.
Right.
And we have to watch this guy until he had 3 bowel movements. And you have to strip him down and everything. And the guy ended up having a bowel movement. Of course, we got to watch it. Believe it or not, you got to search it. All that's disgusting. But so
like a shitty day, bro.
It's a shitty day. Yeah, it's a shitty 8 hours for sure. So anyway, but the supervisor, he pooped on himself and just stuff like, hey, I got to get this guy a change of clothes. No, let him stay there. No. Sorry, I don't do that. You know, I get him to change of clothes. And then, you know, this person wants to try to hit me for disobeying them with a lawful order. And I just wrote them up. I just wrote a report on it. And they got in trouble. I did it. So.
So I always say, like, when I was in prison and you see those officers that are doing the kind of shit that you're talking about, would you say that those officers got picked on when they were a kid?
I would say there's a lot going on. And that's definitely one of it. That's definitely one issue. Yeah. They got picked on when they were a kid. Never been in charge of anything in their life or people, and don't know how to. The biggest disconnect was communication. You got to know how to talk to people. You got to know how to de-escalate things, and you got to know how to give respect. If you give respect, you will get it back 99.9% of the time. It's just that fucking simple. 1 + 1 = 2. It's that.
Yeah. What did you see? Like, I know you said you didn't see a lot as far as like the violence, but I'm sure in other dorms on the compound or maybe at the medium or the low, or what was the craziest thing you heard as far as, like, you know, an officer beating an inmate or an officer got in a relationship with an inmate? Like,
oh, well, now, do you mean violence, meaning officer assaulting inmate or inmate?
Yeah. Officer assaulting inmates.
Okay. Yeah. That I didn't see it, but there were people being arrested for it while I was there. The FBI arrested two officers for an incident on the yard where an officer challenged an inmate to a fight and then dumped them on the ground and then started, you know, and then got the better of them. And then another officer lied on the report. So I know that I didn't, you know, I wasn't involved in that case, but there was, as far as relationships with inmate and staff at the female camp. Yeah. There was an FBI truck arresting people left and right over there. It wasn't cool.
So what did you see as far as inmate on officer violence when you were working there?
Oh, I've seen an inmate stab an officer. I saw that one time. I've seen plenty of, you know, inmates throwing punches at officers, you know, punching an officer and then laying down in the yard like that, you know, just doing stuff, just little shit like that. You know, I saw that. I've seen stabbings. There was a murder while I was there. I worked the case. I was on the evidence recovery team. I've broken up fights. I've broken up stabbings. I've had use of forces where I've had to take weapons off of inmates. Just the normal shit. Nothing special.
And what part of Coleman did you work in? Was it the medium, the low, or the penitentiary? Which part?
I worked at USP one, which is the active gang pen. But the beautiful thing about Coleman was you could do overtime at any of the other institutions. So I got to work at the low, the female camp, the medium, all that, pen two. And I got to see all different levels of custody. And that was a good thing about Coleman.
So when you were working on the USP one, like what gang would you say were running the camp when you were working there?
I would say what they did is right as I left, they brought these ABTs in, Aryan Brotherhood Texas, and they seemed to be starting to make a move to take over everything. You know, they were waiting for, they had this, they, for some reason, they have problems in every place they're at, and they just happened to send them all to us. And as they started coming in and trickling in, they were laying low till they got their numbers straight. And when they got their numbers, that's when they made their move. They started making their moves. But we had, you know, they have the Crips, the Bloods, you got GDs, you got, what are the Nietes, and January 27s, you got the Piru Crips, you got the Zoes, you got all the various Mexican Mafia, all the various gangs, Italian Mafia.
When you were an officer there, man, did you run into any mob figures like the Mafia?
Yeah, I sure did. I ran into a couple big time mob bosses and captains, you know, that you watch on friggin' on some show at night on, you know, Discovery. They would do a profile and I would just laugh and go, yeah, I gave him his mail the other day, and just, you know, laugh. So it was like, you know.
How does their time go in there, man? Because they're not really like in a gang. Like, are they respected in there? Or do they get like, how did they do their time?
They did their time pretty easy, man. They really did. I think the inmates know who they are and they know that, you know, what they're about, but they, you know, they kind of just stick to themselves. They're on their own, you know, and they, you know, they, I'm Italian. So being Italian, we get along with everybody. I don't know if you know any Italians, but we get along with everybody.
Yeah.
and you know, it's just like any Italian, you know, we like good food. We like to chill, you know, and that's how they were. They did easy time.
Yeah. So when you were in Coleman, man, what did you see as far as like drugs on the compounds?
Oh, they had everything in there. That's why, I mean, the war on drugs needs to end. I worked in a prison. They're locked down 24/7 and they got just as much drugs in there as there are out here. You know what I mean? Everything, K2, you know, weed, K2, all that shit, cocaine, heroin. What was the other one? I guess, what was it? I guess the K2 is the one that I guess they get all crazy.
They flack out and gook out and shit.
Yeah, they get all, I've seen a lot of guys freak out on that stuff, you know?
And when you were working there, man, like, what's your opinion on, like, is the Federal Bureau of Prisons set up to rehabilitate people that are incarcerated?
I'd have to say no. Unfortunately, no, it's not.
And why would you say no? Like, what led you to that answer?
Because they closed that. We had a Unicorps services in the federal government. It was I think they call it Pride in Florida, where they build furniture, they build Okay. They called it Unicor, and they shut that down about 6 years ago. They started closing that down, and guys would work there. They would get a good, they would get the highest wage, not a good wage, but they would get the highest wage, but they got job training, which was important. And they got to interact with civilian workers. So it taught them a customer service, gave them customer service experience as well. Well, they took all those down. They shut all those down now. So the guys are sitting around with no jobs, no opportunity to get into the trades or anything like that. And it's unfortunate. They've taken a lot of money from that over the years. And it's unfortunate because that's where you need to keep money in those programs, because that's what's going to give people a skill. It's teach them to fish, right?
Right. Yep.
Teach them to fish. I mean, it's simple.
How, when you were working, man, like out of all your time working at Coleman, would you say that a high percentage of the people that are incarcerated there have an addiction problem?
Yes. Yes. It's drugs. It's either they're addicted to it, they like to sell them, or all three, or all the above.
Do they have any programs for like somebody that goes in with a substance abuse problem?
Yeah, they have an RDAP program. From it takes like a year off or something. From what I hear from talking to the guys that went through it, it doesn't really seem to be that effective. A lot of them are just trying to get their time taken off of, and that's fine. I see that too. I understand that's important too. You got to incentivize shit, you know. But I don't see it. You know, it's like any program. Just like with my physical therapy, you got to really want to do it. You really got to want to do it. You know what I mean? So it takes you as well. But of course, we could do better in those areas with better programs and counselors and stuff. And I would love to see marijuana and THC and CBD incorporated into these programs, because that's what helped stop me from my alcoholism, was discovering cannabis. See, I'm the stone sailor, Josh.
I see you, bro. So when you were working there, man, what would you say is the craziest inmate that you came across that kind of just, you know, either rubbed you the wrong way or, you know, just turned your stomach when you had to interact with him or her?
It wasn't so much the violent ones. It was the one that would cut themselves and cut themselves and cut their stomach open and then go to the hospital. They sew them up. They come back. They'd hit the button. I come, what's the matter? Hey, man, I ate five batteries again. Where the fuck did you get five batteries at? We took everything out of here. I'm like, where did you get them at? I'm like, tell me, please. How the fuck did you have batteries in here? We cleaned this place out. He ate them. We got to take them back. They're cutting them again. Then he would rip the stitches out and dig into his guts, bro. It was disgusting. I mean, tough guys are tough guys, but people that could do shit like that are crazy.
Yeah, facts, bro. When you were working in the Coleman prison, did you ever like go look up inmates that you came across?
Yes, I always did. I had access to their PSI, you know, their pre-sentence investigation. So I was able to look up and verify things and read about their cases and the details and stuff, and the details of their background as well.
So did you ever come across the inmate and you went and looked them up and you were just like, yeah, something don't seem right about this?
Yeah. One time I was conducting a count. I was doing overtime at the low institution. I was conducting a count and I saw this gentleman, because they're in open bay barracks, and I'm counting. Out of the corner of my eye, this guy catches me. His uniform squared away. Pants are creased so nice, you cut your hands on him. And after I finished the count, I came back. His mustache was perfect, military regs, flat top, high and tight. I walked up to him, and I don't ever do this, but I was like, what the fuck are you doing in here? What branch is it? He's like, I was in the Marine Corps for 26 years. I'm retired. I said, wow. I said, geez, I was in the Navy, you know, and I'm retired now. And I said, how did you end up here, man? What happened? And he was like, I went into truck driving when I got out. And somebody offered me some money to transport some guns, and I needed it, and I did. I went through a divorce. She took half of my retirement pay, and I knew that because that happened to me too. So I'm empathizing with this. I'm like, yeah, you got fucked, huh? Yeah, I hear you. I'm like, yeah, taking some guns for $100,000. Yeah, I guess you took a shot. I mean, hey, you took a chance. You know, and I'm sitting there, and I walk back to the office. I'm feeling bad for the guy. I'm like, fuck, man, that's terrible, man. How much time do you got? I got 6 years, Farlow. Okay, good. So he's sitting there, and he's an older guy. He was in his late 50s. And one thing led to another. I got busy. Next thing you know, it's 20, you know, it's 10 o'clock. I count them. That's it. Boom, lights out. And it caught my mind when I'm sitting there after I called in the count. I just checked the guy. And he was telling the truth about something. He was in the Marine Corps for 26 years, and he was a command sergeant major in the Marine Corps, which is the highest enlisted rank. All right. He was that, but he wasn't transporting guns. It was child pornography, child trafficking. And when I read that in his PSI, it was like someone punched me in the gut. I was like, oh my God, you know? And I thought to myself, if his whole life, you mean to tell me that was the first time he engaged in something like this, or the first time he got that? No fucking way.
Yeah, no fucking way.
Yeah. I said, oh my God, if he was transporting kids and stuff, that was just scratching the fucking surface. He was probably with that Epstein Island shit, whatever that fucking Gilligan's Island, whatever the fuck it was.
Yeah. So, man, when I was in prison, like the last bid that I was in and what I saw, it almost seems like that the staff at the prison has like protects the chomos. Is that how it is in the federal system?
You could say that. We have a whole unit dedicated for them. It's a whole extra prison inside the prison. And they chomos are protected because they're preyed upon and they can't walk the yard. Not at Penn 1, they can't. So if their points are high enough, like that Larry Nassar, the guy that molested all the girls at the gym, the gymnastics, he was over there. They beat his ass the first day. They beat his ass.
The Olympic guy, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yep.
He had that coming.
They should, but the thing was, I guess when he got off the bus, he said, no, I'll go on the yard. Okay, motherfucker. He was out of there quick. Because no warden, no administration wants any inmates to die on their watch. You understand? They want to. They don't want that to happen. All right. So they want to ensure that they're safe, because you got to remember care, custody, and control. So the administration has to put them in places safe. They have to have protective custody. And because using the shoe, the special housing, was tantamount to punishing them extra because they didn't commit an infraction. So to keep them in the shoe is punishment, because the shoe is punishment. It's a dungeon in there, right? So instead of keeping them in there, they had to get a unit, kick everybody out of the unit, put a cage, a fence inside the unit, which is inside the prison. So you have a double layer of protection, like a dungeon, just for these guys. So they can have rec, and they could, you know, they brought, like, for instance, they brought them exercise bikes and all kinds of shit in the unit. Man. They could do, they have a medical little, like a little medical clinic in the unit. Like, who the fuck gets that? You know what I'm saying? So, you know, they bring everything to them.
So they build a chomo prison with inside the federal complex to protect them.
You and I will say that, but they'll call it a RSU, re-evaluating something, some bullshit thing. They'll put a fancy title on it, like residential housing, some kind of name, but that's what it's for. You know how they do it.
Yeah, but then they'll close down the Pride warehouse, which is teaching inmates how to make trades and Beautiful. Survive. Yeah, that's crazy, bro. That shit's so ass backwards.
It is, man, especially when you got inmates that literally, okay, the kid dealt in some crack. He had a half a kilo. He drove from here to Georgia, tried to make some money. Well, he got, you know, 25 years. This guy over here got 6 for molesting kids. And this guy's got to see this guy, watch this guy come and go while he's got to do all this fucking time.
Yeah. Yeah, I actually had that happen to me when I was in court, man. Like, I'm going for a violation of probation. The state's like, oh, we want 36 months DOC. Next guy in court goes up and they're like, oh, lewd and lascivious, 2 charges. We'll go with probation on this one. I'm just like, what?
it's these crazy prosecutors, man. I'm telling these young activists, I'm like, listen, stop with this defund the police, defund the prosecutors, because the prosecutors, they don't give a fuck about, all they care about is wins. The humanity in someone, it doesn't matter. Like Josh, if you're a rich kid and you got a good high profile attorney, the prosecutor will give you probation. But if you don't, he'll say, well, this kid's got a good family. He'll be all right. This kid's a piece of garbage. He don't have anybody. He'll be back in the system. So I'm not going to give him a good deal. You know what I'm saying? That's what they do. That's what they do, man.
Yeah, the town I'm from, man, they actually have like a pamphlet of kids that are in elementary school, and they mark them and keep track of them for when they grow up, if they're more likely to be a criminal, and they pay more attention to them. It's crazy, bro. They just did a newspaper article on it. I'll do an episode on it, but.
Do it. You know what? I got something to tell you about that, because you got to remember, I'm the child of an inmate. You understand my, you know what I mean? So
yeah, you've been through it.
I've been through it. Not only that, but I've heard some of the things my colleagues would say about the inmates' kids when they would be playing in the corner at visitation. Oh, they're going to be future inmates when they grow up. And I'm just like, bro, what the fuck's your problem, man? My dad was in prison. Who the fuck are you?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, you automatically assume because this guy's dad's in jail, this kid, he's going to grow up and be in jail. What kind of and then you call yourself a Christian? Get the fuck out of here.
Yeah. I know all about that too.
They want to call themselves Christians. How could you call yourself a Christian and talk like that? I work with some guys like that. Pieces of shit.
Yeah, man. Well, listen, bro, it sounds like you got a lot of stories. I'd love to bring you on for like a part two or part three, if you're down to do that.
Down, man. Thank you. I would love it.
Awesome, bro. So do you have any social media, like an Instagram, YouTube, you want to give a shout out to the people watching at home so they can go check you out?
Yeah, I'm Rob Farlow, AKA the Stone Sailor, as you see behind you right there. I'm currently starting up my own podcast. I'm trying to build some revenue so I can go into the cannabis business and have my own strand, the Stone Sailor cannabis and CBD business. But I also have my podcast. I'm going to be starting very soon. I'm buying some new equipment, but life, liberty, and the pursuit of cannabis. I'll talk about my life all the way from growing up, all the way to the war, to the prison, and where I'm currently at now, recovering from a major spinal injury.
All right, man. Well, hey, I just want to thank you for coming on the channel, man. Definitely going to have you back on. And then when we do that, you can get more into, you know, what your next endeavors are as far as the Stone Sailor and what led you to make that and everything, man.
Becoming the Stone Sailor. Yeah, it's been a journey. An anti-drug guy that got high for the first time at 45 years old. I'm 46 now. And I can't wait to bump into some former inmates of mine on the street and share some nice cannabis with them.
That's what's up, bro.
And wish them all the best, because when you guys get out and you do good, I'm your biggest cheerleader.
Yeah, man, I appreciate that. All right, man, for everybody watching, if you haven't, man, hit that subscribe button, turn on those post notifications on all, so next time we bring the Stone Sailor on, you can hear it first. And with that, it's DOC TV, and we're out.